might take more than a kiss from the princess to turn a frog into a prince. But, according to evolution story, amphibians, such as frogs, really did turn into mammals, including princess. Today, the theory of evolution is considered an established fact, but it wasn't always so. The book of Genesis is a brief glimpse into the mystery of origins, the revelation of a supreme creator to a fallen creation, a truth doubted by few until only a century and a half ago, when an amateur naturalist set out on a voyage of discovery and shook the world with a heretical idea. Exploring the scorching lava beds of the Galapagos Islands, Charles Darwin was fascinated by the strange wildlife. He saw that giant tortoises isolated on different islands were different sizes and shapes. And he imagined that, given enough time, if the tortoises kept on changing, they might eventually be transformed into something entirely different. At Oxford University, Dr. Richard Dawkins is professor of public understanding of science. The author of several best-selling books, he is also one of Darwin's foremost defenders.
I suppose the great mystery of life is to explain where the complexity of life came from. Another way of talking about complexity is to say information. Information is a kind of measure of complexity. And the complexity of life is not just plain complexity, it's also adapted. Living things not only are complicated, but they do things, they survive. They do everything in their power to survive, and they look as though they are beautifully designed machines, machines designed to survive.
But not all experts agree that the complexity of life could have come about by the accumulation of lots of lucky changes. And a growing number of dissenters are questioning Darwin's theory. Molecular biologist Dr. Michael Denton is a senior research fellow at the University of Otago in New Zealand. He claims Darwinism is a theory in crisis, which assumes the so-called fact of evolution, yet cannot explain the supposed transformation of simple life forms into complex creatures by random processes.
I don't think the Darwinian theory of evolution is anything like the established fact that many biologists claim. I call it the great cosmological or cosmogenic myth of the 20th century. And that's a view I still maintain. I think nothing I've seen in the biological sciences, no advances in science that I've seen in the last 20 years, in any way have changed my mind in any way about that fundamental belief of mine that Darwinism is an inadequate explanation.
Darwin's ideas are now conventional wisdom, and it's considered an established fact that simple life forms evolved over millions of years of gradual change into all the complexity and diversity of life that we know today, without the design of a sovereign creator.
And of course, the puzzling thing is, where does all this complexity come from? Where does all this information come from? It cannot come about by chance. It's absolutely inconceivable that you could get something as complicated as a bird and as well designed as a bird or a human or a hedgehog coming about by chance. That's absolutely out. Because to get from nothing, from no complexity, no information, to the extreme complexity of a modern living thing in one step of chance couldn't possibly happen. That would be like throwing a dice 1,000 times and getting a 6 every single time. It's out of the question. But if you allow a little bit of luck in any one generation, and then a little bit of luck in the next generation, a little bit of luck in the next generation, by cumulatively adding this luck, step by step by step by step, you can work from any degree of simplicity to any degree of complexity. All you need is enough time. So where's it come from? It's come from the gradual, incremental process of evolution by natural selection.
It's taken for granted in the modern world of science that ancestral fish appeared in a primeval ocean
then crawled out of the water and became amphibians. Amphibians changed into reptiles, and reptiles into mammals. Evolutionists claim that other reptiles shed their scales, grew feathers, and took to the skies to become birds. But reptiles and birds are very different. Reptiles have no genetic information for wings or feathers. To change a reptile into a bird would require the addition of huge amounts of complex information. Darwin reasoned that, with a bit of luck, the accumulation of enough small changes could even turn reptiles into birds. Michael Denton says it cannot be done.
One can quote lots of examples in the biological realm of things which seem, as it were, beyond the reach of that simple Darwinian mechanism. There's things like the avian lung, there's the feather, there's the amniotic egg, bacterial flagellum. I mean, really a vast number of systems which have that unique watch-like sort of complexity that you find in nature, where in fact, to have the system functioning, you need A, B, C, D, so forth, all in place, interlocking like together, before the thing will function. It's very difficult to see how those sorts of things were arrived at undirected, by undirected processes. I mean, you could take the feather, for example. The flight feather is a very complicated structure of tiny interlocking hooks and barbules which hold the parts of the feather together. And it's these tiny little micro-adaptations within the feather which give it its which adapt the feather for flight. And the Darwinian model of evolution requires that the intermediates are fully functional. And I can't imagine how you can get to such ends without having to sort of go through structures which are really not functional in some sense, in some biological sense.
Reptiles and birds also have totally different reproductive and respiratory systems. In reptilian lungs, air passes in and out of only one tube, which ends in tiny air sacs. But in birds, the air flows continually through the lungs in one direction, through a complex system of interconnected air sacs connected up with its hollow bones. Darwinists claim that reptilian lungs changed into birds' lungs through a lot of intermediate stages. But Michael Denton says half-formed lungs won't work because the transitional form cannot breathe. Any intermediate stage would result in extinction of the species.
Well, the avian lung is an example, like the living cell or like the feather, of a highly complicated system, very, very involved, very complicated, which, as far as I can see, you can only conceive of it functioning as for respiratory gas exchange. If the whole current structure and order of it is in place. One of the toughest examples in nature of a highly complex system composed of a whole lot of interacting components, all of which must be there as they are in every single bird's lung before the thing would function. In the case of the avian lung, this is, for me, a very tough nut for Darwinists to crack, because, I mean, I can't imagine how that sort of the lung and other analogous things like it could come about as a result of the accumulation of small random changes.
For simple life forms to evolve into more complex ones requires a massive input of new information. A microbe has about two books of 500 pages of complex coded genetic information on its DNA. A human has the equivalent of at least 1,000 books. To transform a microbe into a human means adding a whole library of new information. So where does this new information come from? Professor Werner Gitt is a specialist in information theory and a director at the Federal Institute of Physics and Technology in Brunswick, Germany. He says the evolution of complex life forms from simpler ones by selection of lucky improvements is impossible, because there is no source of new information.
The biggest problem in evolution is the origin of information. Where is the information coming from? It is impossible to come from a simple living being to an elephant or to a human being. It needs very much more information. And information cannot come in by a random process.
Darwinists say the new information comes from genetic mutations that are passed on from one generation to the next. Genetic mutations are random errors, rather like mistakes made when copying a text. According to evolutionists, the most favorable of these mutations are preserved by natural selection.
And it's the molecular genetics which finally provide the detailed evidence, the absolute knockdown evidence that nobody could possibly go against, because the molecular evidence really shows with the detail of just like a sort of human text, you can see the changing letters, the changing words of the DNA, which are in effect describing, as generations go by, describing the anatomical changes, which are all that Darwin himself was able to see.
Genetic mutations occur when genes are damaged, often by exposure to radiation or toxic chemicals. Some mutations have no effect, but most are detrimental, and they're often fatal. Although most mutations are harmful, some mutations may be beneficial. Darwin has claimed that evolution occurs when these rare beneficial mutations accumulate through natural selection. The Galapagos Islands are the showcase of evolution, where the unique wildlife is studied by international scientists. Here, tourists are shown the flightless cormorant as an example of evolution through beneficial mutation. The Galapagos cormorant has lost the genetic information for wings, and without wings, it can swim and dive quite well, which may be an advantage. Galapagos tour guides explain that because of this apparent advantage, the flightless cormorant left more offspring, and so, through natural selection, it survived, while the other birds with wings died out.
Flightless cormorants are really degenerate mutants with a loss of information for making wings. All examples of mutations are actually loss of information, even the favourable ones. There is no new genetic information. Claimed examples of evolution in action are actually examples of variation within a kind. Antibiotic resistance, insecticide resistance, peppered moths, all these are examples of rearrangement of existing genetic information or loss of genetic information. There's no new genetic information.
If you reject the sufficiency of chance, undirected chance, as an explanation for biological phenomena as we see them on Earth, then you have to have some form of design hypothesis. This is the only alternative available. I think when you look at the laws of nature and you look at the cosmos, you have these two conflicting possibilities. You have the possibility of the transcendent Hebraic God who created the world and organized all the laws of nature to this end, or you have the other possibility that somehow the universe is a living whole, a self-organizing system.
At the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem, Orthodox Jews worship the God of creation. According to the book of Genesis, it is by design, not chance, that we came into existence. Israeli biophysicist Dr. Lee Spetner is uniquely qualified to comment on the role of mutations in evolutionary theory. A specialist in the physics and mathematics of information, he has researched the signal-noise relationships in DNA as a Johns Hopkins University fellow. He has published in leading journals on theoretical and mathematical evolutionary biology. He believes the evidence supports the biblical account that God created certain basic types, which have, through time, diversified as they adapted to their environment.
I really do not believe that the neo-Darwinian model can account for large-scale evolution. What they really can't account for is the buildup of information. It's very improbable that there can be many small steps of evolution, many small changes adding up to one large change. And not only is it improbable on the mathematical level, that is theoretically, but experimentally, one has not found a single mutation that one can point at that actually adds information. In fact, every beneficial mutation that I have seen reduces the information, it loses information.
Australia's Royal Show in Perth is the place to show off your purebred. If it cannot be seen that mutations and natural selection increase genetic complexity, what about artificial selection? Selective breeding does produce great variety, but is there a limit to the change?
Charles Darwin himself made great play of domestication. And a nice way to look at this is to say, suppose you wanted to do an experiment, to actually demonstrate experimentally that this process of selection worked. What would you do? Well, what you'd do would be you'd say, well, it'll take me about 1,000 years, but given 1,000 years, what I can do is in every generation, I can breed for those qualities that I want to get. So for the next 1,000 years, what we're going to do is in every generation, we're going to mimic natural selection by choosing for breeding those individuals which most embody the qualities that we admire. So if you can go from, say, a wolf to a Pekingese in a few 1,000 years, then you have to extrapolate that process and say, how much further could you go in 1,000,000,000 years?
You can breed dogs for thousands and millions of years, but if you have no source of new genetic information, they'll still be dogs. The problem with evolution is it has no way of providing new genetic information. Both natural selection and breeding, or artificial selection, cause loss of the genetic information. If we take a long-haired dog and we only breed from long-haired dogs and just select the long-haired pups and let them breed in the future, then we end up with a variety of dog which concentrates all the genes for long hair in one variety. But that means that that dog can never breed a short-haired dog because it does not have the genes for short hair. So we've lost genetic information. Natural selection does the same. If we take wolves, varieties of wolves before the Ice Age, long hair, short hair, and during the Ice Age, the extreme cold resulted in the killing off of the short-haired wolves, we end up with a new variety of wolf, even a new species, with long hair, which has adapted to cold conditions. But this adaptation, again, is not involving new genetic information. In fact, the process causes the loss of the genetic information for short hair. Great diversity is possible through the new combinations of existing genes. Even mutations can cause rearrangements of chromosomes and degenerate changes, a loss of information which creates diversity. This is a fundamental problem. Mutations and natural selection both result in loss of genetic information. So there is no way that evolution of increasing complexity can occur.
It is impossible that new information is coming from a random process. If you see a computer program, it needs a programmer. If you see a car, it needs a designer. If we see the biological information in the cells, then we must say, that is the right conclusion, it needs a creator who has made the program, the genes, to create the proteins, to create the organs. It is necessary that we have this. So we can say evolution is an impossible process.
Every school child learns the supposed evolution of the horse, from tiny ones with multiple toes to large one-toed modern horses.
What were their ancestors like? You can trace the evolution of equids, the clues are in their skulls, feet, and teeth. From four toes to one toe, from short teeth to long teeth, from browsers to grazers. Choose one of the lighted buttons. Choose now.
But has the horse really evolved? Many scientists doubt it.
There are many different varieties of horses we can get through breeding, but they're still just horses. We can get large ones, small ones, even ones with three toes. Evolutionists put these into a sort of a sequence and add a fossil rock badger at the bottom and then claim that's evidence for evolution. But you take out the fossil rock badger and you just have variation within a kind. Horses breed horses. That's not evolution.
The information required for large-scale evolution can really not come from random mutations. The Darwinian model says that it does, but nobody has ever made a calculation to show that it does. I've made a calculation that shows that it doesn't.
Professor Dawkins, can you give an example of a genetic mutation or an evolutionary process which can be seen to increase the information in the genome?
There's a popular misunderstanding of evolution which says that fish turned into reptiles and reptiles turned into mammals, and so somehow we ought to be able to look around the world today and look at our ancestors. We ought to be able to see the intermediates between fish and reptiles, or between reptiles and mammals. We ought to be able to see fish kind of on the way to becoming reptiles. But of course that's not the way it is at all. Fish are modern animals. They're just as modern as we are. They're descended from ancestors, which we're descended from. Way back 300 million years ago, there would have been an ancestor, which was the ancestor of modern fish and the ancestor of modern humans. And that ancestor, if you could have been there then, you could have seen the first steps towards a fish, say, coming out onto the land and becoming a something like an amphibian. But that was a long time ago. You wouldn't expect to see that today.
If one were to believe the Neo-Darwinian account, you would have to say that information is built up gradually in small steps, a little bit at a time. And if one examines the mathematics of this sort of thing happening, it turns out that one has to assume that at any stage in evolution that there are a large number of possible mutations that could occur that could be adaptive. And if there are a large number, we should be able to find some today. And the fact is that we don't. All the mutations that have been examined on a molecular level show that the organism has lost information and not gained it.
The Genesis account of creation implies that virtually all genetic information existing today was present in the original kinds. So, great variation is possible within each kind, but one basic kind cannot change into another. Michael Denton believes information can only come from an intelligent source.
And I tend to think that, in fact, the evidence suggests a transcendent sort of Hebraic God of the Judeo-Christian tradition. An external creator made the world and gave it its order, its pattern, and its ends. It's consistent, I think, with the evidence, though. It's consistent with it.
Just as the information in books has to come from an intelligent source, so the huge amount of genetic information in living things must come from an intelligent creator. The evidence fits the biblical model, where there's a large amount of genetic information created in the beginning, allowing adaptation within the kind and being degraded since. The information had to be programmed into the living things in the beginning. Living things did not evolve They were created.
If we look to the Bible, then we see there is a creator. The creator has made all things, the material processes and also the information.
Evolutionists believe complex life forms came from simpler ones, but random processes with natural selection can't account for it, and it's never been observed or replicated. The accumulation of gradual changes produced by lucky chance has never been shown to add new information or increase complexity. Creationists believe that all the evidence points to a creator. Dogs may be hairy or bald, and frogs may be spotted or green, but dogs will be dogs, and frogs will always be frogs. Even with a kiss from a princess, a frog will never become a prince.